Hello, this is Professor Werwath. There's been a lot of news lately about frozen EVs in Chicago. Our temperatures dropped below 15 degrees below zero for several days in a row. This played havoc in the city, especially with regard to electric vehicles. It appeared to be mostly Teslas, but I'm sure it wasn't limited to Teslas. At Tesla superchargers, getting frozen, unable to charge, unable to charge quickly, unable to move the vehicle. And basically having the equivalent of a traffic jam at these EV charging locations to the point where they were almost paralyzed. So this became a catastrophe that was documented extremely well on so many other YouTube channels. I will certainly let you check out those videos. I'm going to give you my take in terms of what happened, as well as my take as to how to prevent this in the future. And I'm not going to take any hostages here or spare any feelings. Basically, I'm going to look across the spectrum at both drivers, car companies, and charging companies, because I think in many ways this was a perfect storm. This came out of the blue, and it was a combination of factors. It wasn't just one factor that caused this catastrophe. So again, it all came together, right? EV drivers who had only public charging to rely on. So many cars are rented from Hertz, for example, and others that have EVs, but they have no way to charge them. No way to charge them at home, no way to charge them at work. The only option they have is public charging. So whenever you're relying completely on public charging, you're setting yourself up to fail. And what I tell people who want to buy an EV is make sure you can charge at home reliably or at work reliably, ideally both, and you will have a good experience. If you have neither, I can almost guarantee you will have a bad experience, even if you live next to a public charger, even if it's high speed, even if it's usually available. One day in the future, maybe tomorrow, you will be disappointed. It'll be down, it'll be busy, and frankly, charging every night at home, in your garage or in some home location that is convenient to you is probably one of the best advantages of an EV. And when you don't have that, I'm not really sure why you would want an EV. Uber and Lyft drivers use rented Teslas for their business. So they're back to, they have to charge multiple times per day to just to maintain their business. If they drive over 150 miles or even, close to that, they're probably going to have to charge. And that could be easily a couple of times a day. People who live in apartments and have no garage, right? Travelers and visitors from other locations, and local folks with free charging from charging providers. These are all the demands that I could think of that are going into the public charging network. Of those, I've bolded the one that I think is truly legitimate on a 24/7 basis, and that is travelers and visitors. If you have ever been a traveler or a visitor, I am sure you were frustrated by the locals who are simply using the chargers because they're free. They could live across the street with a, electrical outlet near their house, and yet, they're saving a few nickels by charging at a public charger, monopolizing the few slots that are out there. So, yes, we have a shortage of charging equipment and infrastructure, but frankly, we compound it by doing some of this other idiocy of, Hertz renting out tens of thousands of electric vehicles with no way to charge except for public charging, Uber and Lyft drivers using rented Teslas, et cetera. So, the second thing to notice, and we that obviously contributed to this problem, was battery degradation in the winter, which has been well documented across the internet. So it's slower to charge, right? Reduced performance, reduced range. Below 50 degrees, it starts, and below 20 degrees, it becomes pretty pronounced in terms of easily 40 to 50% loss of range. 40 to 50% loss of range in the cold, in the bitter cold. And then, of course, lack of preheating. So if you're parked outdoors, it's very difficult to preheat. Preheat typically happens when you're on the road within a 20-minute or 30-minute distance to the high-speed charging equipment. You have to tell the car that you're going to a high-speed charger, and it will kick in many cases. Many cars are equipped with preconditioning. And that preconditioning heats up the battery so that it prepares the battery to accept the high voltage charge, right? What else happened? Charging infrastructure was damaged, impaired, blocked by snow, blocked by ice. Sometimes the charging cable itself was packed with ice. Sometimes it was left on the ground and frozen to the ground. In other cases, it was literally unable to turn on or the network connections were somehow not working. So you have charging problems, you have battery problems, you have driver problems. And then, of course, the instinct that everybody has to top off at the same time, right? So all a big rush, big demand, big peak. Drivers abandoning their cars, which means that they're blocking that spot for somebody else, right? And then tow truck drivers towing cars to the stalls and then leaving them there without the driver to attend to the vehicle. So all of these factors and possibly more came together in what might have been, I don't know, the worst 72 hours of EV charging in Chicago's history. What can drivers do to avoid this, right? Charge at home or work whenever possible. Do not use or rely on the public charging network. Keep your battery warm by parking indoors, meaning in a garage if you have it. Garages, even when they're detached, can typically be warmer than the outside temperatures. I have one that's attached to my house and it's easily 20, maybe 30 degrees warmer. So when it's 10 below outside, it was literally 30 above. It was right around freezing or above freezing in my garage. So precondition the battery as much as possible. If you know how that works on your car, initiate that. Typically, it's through the nav system. You have to navigate to a high-speed charger. These logic in the car says, well, if we're, within a 30-mile radius, we will precondition the battery to get it warm and prepare it for the high-speed charge, right? Recognize the reduced range as a driver. Avoid going below 20% state of charge. Lots of bad things happen when you go below 20% state of charge. People don't realize this, but you have two batteries, the 12-volt battery and the high-voltage battery. The 12-volt is for the accessories, but it also starts the car. It also opens the locks. It also operates your wiper blades and your headlights and everything that a traditional car relies on 12 volts for. That's pretty much what happens with an EV. That 12-volt battery is charged by the high-voltage battery and the high-voltage system. So as a result, what you want to do is make sure you don't go below 20%, because that logic for warming up the battery and that logic for charging the 12-volt battery all relies on the state of charge. And you need to be at least 20% to keep that going. So again, flip side, don't charge above 80 or 90%. This is both bad for the battery and it monopolizes the chargers, because that time to get from 80 to 100 or 90 to 100% is very, very long. It's not linear. It takes a lot longer to get that last few percentage points of charge. So you are monopolizing a charger, you're hurting your battery, you're damaging everyone behind you in terms of keeping them from charging. Attend to your session, right? Don't leave your car abandoned while you're charging. Watch it to make sure that when you are fully charged, you can leave and open up that slot for somebody else. Otherwise, you are wasting their time, you're wasting your time, you're monopolizing stations. And I don't think that there's much in the way of any kind of financial penalty. There's some chargers that have idle fees. You might be invoking idle fees in some cases. And in most cases, I think you should be invoking idle fees, because it should motivate you to get your car out of that slot, right? Make sure you put away the charging cables when you're done. Make sure they're properly stowed away so that they don't get exposed to the elements and get packed with snow and ice. Please show courtesy to others. Help the new folks when you can. Avoid the temper tantrums and recognize that everyone's in the same boat. We're all trying to leverage the same infrastructure under tough conditions. I would advise drivers of EVs to maintain your 12-volt battery by keeping a booster. These little handy boosters will keep your 12-volt battery charged in the event that it's discharged. If you can't start your car, it could very well be the 12-volt battery and not the high-voltage system that's at fault. These little $80 boosters is something that I keep in all of my EVs as an emergency. Much better than jumping cables. I'm not even sure jumper cables work on EVs, but I'm pretty sure these do. Make sure you get the right brand, make sure you test it out, and make sure you keep this charged, because this requires some maintenance as well. So make sure that this is plugged in every few weeks or months so that this doesn't discharge on its own. Recognize that EVs do discharge on their own. The big battery will discharge as much as 1 or 2% per day just sitting there, right? It could be even more. So over the course of, let's say, 20 days, you might wind up with a dead battery. So do not park an EV, especially in the cold, and let it sit idle for any length of time. I would say the most you should do is possibly 10 days. And then recognize that you're going to need a charge almost immediately after those 10 or 12 days of sitting outside, especially in the cold. What can charging companies do? I think there's a lot they can do to keep this from happening again. And I'm sure they have a lot of motivation. This bad press can't be good for their business, right? Keep your equipment well insulated, keep it in good working order, better layouts to facilitate removal of snow and access to the chargers. I'm sure many of these chargers were blocked. If you look at the way they're laid out, they're at the edges and the peripheral of a parking lot, and these snow truck drivers are just literally, jamming the snow into the, into where the charging spots are. So access was blocked in many cases because of snow and ice buildup. Penalize the drivers, please, for staying too long at a charger. Idle fees should be established, and if they're not high enough, they should be raised. I know that's controversial. I'm sure I'll get a lot of negative feedback, but frankly, idle fees motivate people to leave when they should leave. In other words, when their car is done charging, right? As opposed to hanging around, maybe grabbing another cup of coffee or another beer with the guys. No. Get your car out of there so somebody else can use the charger, right? Be prepared as a charging company to remove cars from stalls if they're no longer charging, if they're beyond the max allowed time, if they've been abandoned. What do you do if there's nobody looking out for the charging equipment, right? And I know many of these stalls are unattended. And maybe that is part of the major problem here is unattended stalls have no way of determining which car should be removed, who's going to call a tow truck company, who's going to supervise that process. In many cases, the answer is nobody, nada, right? Stop, please, please, please stop giving away free charging. I appreciated the free charging, but we're no longer in our infancy. We are now in our terrible teens. And as a result, right, we have way too many cars and we're not enough infrastructure. Free charging aggravates that. People go to charge because it's free. They could charge at home, but why should I? I can get it for no money on the road, or I could go home and spend money. I'll do it for free on the road. So free charging is aggravating the situation, especially those that have unlimited free charging. And many cars do have unlimited free charging for the first year, 2 years, 3 years, depending on who you bought it from, when you bought it, and what the deal that they have, often with companies like Electrify America, who've been giving away free charging now for what, 3, 4, 5 years? This is a catastrophe, right? And in my mind, stop the free charging under extreme conditions. Make it clear to all of your customers, below 20 degrees Fahrenheit, you will not give away free charging to anybody. Even if it was promised to you, you will have to pay. Everybody will have to pay under 20 degrees Fahrenheit. That to me makes sense, right? What can car companies do? Included a simple indicator about battery temperature so the drivers can see when the battery temperature is low. Make sure it's clear when it's too low and it's not safe or it's not proper to operate. Let people know when it's appropriate to turn on battery preconditioning. And oh, by the way, how about having a simple switch or button so that you can easily turn on battery preconditioning? Why do I have to program my nav system? And I'm sure this is true for Tesla. I know it's true for Kia. This is how it works for Kia and for Hyundai, right? Battery preconditioning is something that happens in the background. And it only happens if you have your nav system turned on and it's programmed to go to a charging station. I think it should be more explicit. I think there should be a button for this. You can turn it on and turn it off, whether it's a physical button or a virtual button. I don't care. I just want some sort of visual indication and positive action required or capable from the driver, right? Provide real-time advice to the drivers as to when battery precondition is even needed. So that they know, hey, I'm not going to be able to charge very quickly unless I turn this on now, right? Provide better training. All these new drivers, whether it's Hertz or Avis or Uber or Lyft, they're all new to electric vehicles. Nobody's been training these folks. They don't know what to expect. They don't know how to manage or operate their EV. So in my mind, that's better training. How that gets done, YouTube videos, what have you. But I think it needs to be done for all new drivers. Hertz, if they're renting a car for the first time, an EV to somebody who's never driven one, definitely needs to be training their customers on how to use and maintain and properly operate their EVs. selling, getting rid of, and dumping 20,000 EVs at once is one small indicator that their customers don't know how to drive EVs, right? One thing car companies can do, of course, stop selling large number of EVs to car rental agencies until all of these kinks have been worked out. All the training, all the orientation, all of the EV charging. I have yet to see an EV charger that has the name Hertz on it, right? Or the name Avis. So if you're, renting these cars, I think the least you can do is start putting some infrastructure in place. And lastly, please, car companies, use some battery chemistries that are more resilient to the cold. I suspect that in and of itself is a huge, impediment to both the adoption of EVs and the proper operation. So with that, that's what I have to say. I'm hoping some of this makes sense. Much of this I've not seen anywhere else. So especially the last two or three slides. Give it some thought. Hopefully car companies will step up. Hopefully the charging infrastructure will improve. Those are the things I'm hearing, right? That everybody sees the problem, everyone's working on it. The federal government has applied, hundreds of millions and then soon billions of dollars towards this problem of building out the infrastructure. I hope it'll be in time. Thank you.